بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله على سيدنا ونبينا أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد. وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين، لا سيما بقية الله في الأرضين، أجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف. اللهم أخرجني من ظلمات الوهم وأكرمني بنور الفهم. اللهم افتح علينا أبواب رحمتك وانشر علينا خزائن علومك برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. إن شاء الله with Allah's blessing and assistance, we are going to have today few sessions on self-development. I cannot do justice with this topic, but we will try to, inshallah, benefit from the time which is available as much as we could. And right at the beginning, I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to put his own light, inshallah, in what we say, what we hear, in the time that we spend together, so that inshallah by the end of the day we all live here fully, inshallah, energized and determined, inshallah, to implement what we learn. The first thing that we want to discuss is about self-purification. Some of the things that we say today is in the book Self-Development, that many of you have got, Self-Development, which is based on different series we had in the past on Islamic spirituality. And sometimes the lectures were given to Muslims, sometimes to non-Muslims. They wanted to know something about Islamic spirituality. And then there was a course in London, Self-Building. So all these ideas were put together and published in 8 papers. And then with some further work recently published as this book, Self-Development. So some of the ideas are here, some are not. Self-purification is here in the first essay, but we may, you know, add some of the extra points to it. There is a kind of fundamental question here. Maybe if we understand this, we don't need anything more, if we understand this point properly. And that is what we want to do with our life. What Allah expects from us to do. Allah has created us, so He is the best person to tell us what is the right purpose for our life. Yeah, the one who has designed something and created something knows the best use of that thing which has been created. So what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala want from us, expects from us? What is it that if we achieve, the purpose that He had has been achieved? And if we don't achieve, we have wasted ourselves. You know, according to the Quran, sometimes people harm themselves. For example, you know the concept of doing injustice to yourself. For example, we say, Rabbana innana zalamna anfusana. We have done injustice to ourselves. Because Allah has given us great capital, great capacity, talents, and if we don't use them properly, we have done zulm to ourselves. Sometimes, instead of saying zulm to ourselves, Allah says they have lost themselves. Alladhina khasiru anfusahum. Khasiru anfusahum. It's a very beautiful concept. You know, imagine a businessman. A businessman sometimes doesn't make profit. But this is not called in Arabic khasara. If you don't make profit, it's not called khasara. But when you lose your capital, this is khasara. Imagine you, for example, invested $1 million and you are just earning enough to keep your $1 million. You are not making any addition to it. This is not khasara. But if your $1 million is becoming less and less, this is khasara. Like a person who is selling ice in very hot weather. If he doesn't find a customer to sell the ice, this is khasara, because heat of sun is melting the ice. So it's khasara. We human beings are like ice under sunshine. إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٌ. Unless you manage to gain something quickly, make some profits that can cover your loss and something more. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. And although Iman and Amal Salih are what we need, and in many verses only these two are mentioned, but in order to be able to maintain your Iman and Amal Saleh, you need group work, teamwork. وَتَوَاسَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاسَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. تَوَاسِي بِالْحَقِّ and تَوَاسِي بِالصَّبْرِ are not two extra requirements next to Iman and Amal Saleh. These are two techniques to be able to have Iman and Amal Saleh. Otherwise, if you want to act as a person, as an individual in this challenging world, you cannot keep your Iman and Amal Saleh, let alone grow them. Okay? So, we are in loss. Sometimes this loss is so fundamental that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, خَسِرُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ. Is not just khasaru in their actions. Sometimes khasara is action. قُلْ هَلْ أُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِالْأَخْسَرِينَ أَعْمَالًا. Some people lose in their actions because they make something, they don't benefit from actions. But sometimes people lose themselves. Imagine, you know, if a person does gambling. Sometimes people do gambling, unfortunately, you know, gambling is an addiction. So it's very difficult for people to stop it. This is why Islam says, you know, don't go near haram, because if you go near haram, then to come out is very difficult. So imagine a person does gambling. First, what they do, they put their pocket money, their bank money. Unfortunately, some people, even they put their home, their car in gambling. Now imagine if a person sells himself and says, I become your abd, and does qumar on himself. Then this is greatest khasara. So not only akhsarina a'mala, it can reach alladhina khasiru anfusahum. So if we sell ourselves and we become a servant of shaitan, a servant of shahawat, a servant of people, this is great loss. Because we are created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as free. Amirul Mumineen alayhi salam said, لا تكن عبد غيرك قد جعلك الله حرا. Even when it comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's very interesting. Although Allah is our creator, but still, he leaves it to us to serve him. He wants us to serve him as a hur, as a free person. He didn't want us to be forced to serve him. There is no beauty for human beings to do something by force. إِنَّا هَدَيْنَاهُ السَّبِيلِ إِمَّا شَاكِرًا وَإِمَّا كَفُورًا. So, the whole purpose of our life which can save us and keep us away from khasara, from loss, is what? This is what we have to achieve. According to the Quran, we can say the purpose of our life is perfection. The purpose of our life is purity, piety, which is coming when we get nearer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah is the purest of the pure. For us to get closer to Him is we have to purify ourselves. Therefore, you find that Quran talks about tazkiyatun nafs, purification of the soul. Unfortunately, in some understandings of spirituality, even among some Muslims, but more so among non-Muslims, they are not very much concerned about purification of the soul. They are more concerned about the strengthening of soul. So they say, we have physical power, which comes from our muscles. We have a spiritual power which is reserved, and to release it, you have to strengthen your soul by reducing your reliance on physics, your reliance on body, your reliance on food and drink and sleeping and animal desires. You strengthen your soul, you release a spiritual force which is there inside you. You can do wonders. You can stop a train which is moving. You can read minds of people. You can do lots of things. You can go from one part of the world to the other part of the world. Some people are interested in these things. But this is not the Quranic idea. The Quranic idea is that the main thing is purity. Tazkiyatun nafs. The main thing is not to have some power that other people don't have. Unfortunately, sometimes people have more interest in these strange ideas and strange, you know, powers, secrets, and then they forget sometimes most obvious things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in four places in the Quran talks about tazkiyatun nafs as a very important part of the tasks of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One of those four cases is in the dua of Ibrahim ala nabiyyina wa alihi wa alayhi salam and Ismail. You have it in the book. It's in Quran, Surah Baqarah, verses 127 to 129. وَإِذْ يَرْفَعُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ الْقَوَاعِدَ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ وَإِسْمَاعِيلِ. When Ibrahim and Ismail together were raising the foundations of Bayt, Kaaba. Because you know, Kaaba was built before, but was destroyed. So they were building again, restoring Kaaba. In that moment, imagine Ibrahim, who is a prophet, is asked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to restore and purify the house of Allah. Tahira baytiya, purify, clean my house. For people who want to come for tawaf, for itikaf, for prayer. In that time, Ibrahim must be so proud that I am restoring the house of Allah. Allah has chosen me for this mission. But humbleness of Ibrahim doesn't let him to be proud. Humbleness of Ibrahim doesn't let him to take the favor of Allah upon him as a sign of privilege. Unfortunately, whenever Allah has some favor upon us, we think this is because I'm special. Do you know why Allah has given me these things? Because I am special. Otherwise, Allah is wise. He's not going to give things to the people who don't deserve. So I deserve this. But this is not the way awliyaullah look at themselves. Whatever Allah gives them, they don't find why Allah has given them except His fazl. They don't find anything special in themselves. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, in that moment, is even worried about acceptability of what he's doing. Imagine, you are prophet of Allah, making house of Allah according to the command of Allah, but still you are worried whether this is acceptable or not. Rabbana taqabbal minna, please accept this from us. Innaka antas sami'ul alim, you are truly hearing and knowing. You are hearing our prayer and you know of our intention. Okay, so please accept, or you know of our need and intention. Rabbana waj'alna muslimayni lak. One of the things that you learn from this ayah is that when you have opportunity of dua, don't just ask one thing. You know, imagine there is a person that after a long time you have managed to meet. Ask him whatever you want to ask. Take from him whatever you can take. When mu'min is in the moment of dua, should think that maybe this is my last chance of dua. Let me take everything that I want from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't say, you know, in the night also I'm having to say prayer. Tomorrow I'm going to say my prayer. Night of Jummah. No. In every opportunity of dua, you should think that this is maybe my last chance. And take as much as you need. How much you need? There is no limit for our need. So Ibrahim and Ismail didn't just stop with acceptability of restoration of Kaaba. They went beyond. وَجَعَلْنَا مُسْلِمَيْنِ لَكْ. We want to be submissive to you. So we start with this request of accepting our restoration, but we want to go beyond and please make us submissive to you. And not only us, وَمِن ذُرِّيَّتِنَا أُمَّةً مُسْلِمَةً لَكْ. How far-sighted they were and how much they were concerned about their zurriya. You know, one of the things about Ibrahim alayhi salam is that he was always concerned about his zurriya. Maybe natural way of explaining it is because he was waiting for having zurriya for a long time. But maybe it's not just because of that. Maybe because Ibrahim alayhi salam, even if he didn't have zurriya, he was a person who had love like father. You know, there are people who have no children, but they are really like father and mother. Ibrahim was very concerned, very caring person, very loving person. So, please, among our zurriya, also make a nation, ummatan, muslimatan, lak. So, It's very ambitious dua. They didn't want from their Zurriya be individuals who are submissive. They wanted a nation to be submissive. Look at the ambition. وَأَرِنَا مَنَاسِكَنَا. And please show us our rites, rituals. Manasik, A'mal. Again, one of the things from Quran we can learn about Ibrahim alayhi salam is that Ibrahim was very interested in seeing things. رَبِّ أَرِنِي كَيْفَ تُحْيَ الْمَوْتَ أَرِنِي مَلَكُوتَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ أَرِنَا مَنَاسِكَنَا. Not in the sense of seeing by eyes, in the sense of I want to have a knowledge which is like seeing, a knowledge which is coming with clarity, with wuzu, clarity and certainty. This is what everyone should try to have. Don't be satisfied with anything other than seeing malakut. رَبَّ أَرِنِي مَلَكُوتَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ أَرِنَا مَنَاسِكَنَا أَرِنِي كَيْفَ تُحْيَ الْمَوْتَى وَتُبْ عَلَيْنَا. What does tub alayna mean? You know, every tawbah that we do, we had this also in self-knowledge, every tawbah that we do is indeed surrounded by two tawbah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah also does two tawbah. Of course, as a joke, we can say his first tawbah is why he created us. I'm joking. So, tawbah is, in the case of Allah, return. Because the literal meaning of tawbah is to return, not regret. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first returns to us so that we get tawfiq for doing tawbah. Okay? What is the ayah? Taballahu alayhim liyatubu. Taballahu alayhim liyatubu. The example that we normally use is, imagine you have a child who has made, you know, some mischief and now has run away from home. As a father or mother, you very much want your child to come back. You don't want your child to stay on the street, sleep on the street, mix with the people who are there. But you don't want to also spoil him. So you send your neighbor, you know, uncle, someone, say, you know, please go and speak to him and bring him back to me. So who has the initiative? You. So for Tawbah, Allah has the initiative. أَنْتَ الَّذِي فَتَحْتَ لِعِبَادِكَ بَابًا وَسَمَّيْتَهُ بِالْتَوْبَةِ فَقُلْتَ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا تُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ. Allah invites us to go back to Him. So first He returns to us and invites us to go back to Him. And then when we go back to Him, then again He returns to us and embraces us with His forgiveness. Like now that the child goes back to mother and father, they embrace him. So there are two returns from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and one return from us. So Ibrahim and Ismail are telling Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, please toba alayna, return to us, accept our tawbah. Innaka anta tawwabur rahim. You are most returning and merciful. Rabbana. This is where we wanted to refer. I was so excited about the ayah that I mentioned more details, but the point was here. رَبَّنَا وَبْعَثْ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ. I don't think this was their own dua. I think this cannot be something unless Allah put in their heart. Yeah? How can Ibrahim and Ismail in that time foresee a prophet coming in Akhiru Zaman? It's Allah's. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts in our mind what we can ask from Him. Yes? رَبَّنَا وَبْعَثْ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ. Please raise among our progeny a messenger. You know, like someone who has no child, okay, he can say, oh Allah, please give me child. So this is very simple dua. Allah, give me a child. But if you want to follow the example of Ibrahim, instead of saying, Allah, give me a child, you say, Allah, in my zurriya, put maraja. So not only are you asking for a child, you are asking for generations, and then you want from them to be maraja. So he didn't just want ask, you know, something simple. He asked his zurriya to carry on, and then from them to be a rasul. Even he didn't say, send a rasul to them. He said, وَبْعَثْ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ. I want that rasul not only to be sent to them, to be also from them. Very clever, very ambitious. Unfortunately, we use our ambition in, you know, worldly affairs. We don't use our ambition in spiritual affairs. وَبْعَثْ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ يَتْلُوْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكَ. Who would recite to them your verses, your communications. وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ. Who would teach them the book, the wisdom, وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ, and purifies them. إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in three verses says that actually this dua was accepted. In the book you have all the references. In Surah Baqarah verse 151, Surah Jum'ah verse 2, Ali Imran 164, all refer to this dua of Ibrahim. When Allah says, He actually raised that messenger. For example, in Surah Baqarah verse 151, كَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا فِيكُمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْكُمْ يَتْلُوْ عَلَيْكُمْ آيَاتِنَا وَيُزَكِّيكُمْ وَيُعَلِّمُكُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ وَيُعَلِّمُكُمْ مَا لَمْ تَكُونُوا تَعْلَمُونَ. In Surah Jum'ah, هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة. سورة آل عمران لقد من الله على المؤمنين إذ بعث فيهم رسولا من أنفسهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة. So now you understand that the issue of tazkiyah is not something simple. The issue of tazkiyah, purification, is something that even Ibrahim and Ismail had thought about it and had requested Allah to send a messenger who would purify people. Just in four verses of the Quran, we have this idea, plus other verses that inshallah I'm going to refer. This also shows greatness of Ibrahim ala nabiyyina wa alihi wa alayhi salam. So, what is tazkiyah? Of course, there are many things to say about, you know, this tazkiyah and ta'aleem. I don't have time. I just go to the notion of tazkiyah. Tazkiya comes from zakawa. You know, in Arabic we have zakat. Zaka yasku zakatan. Zakat, when we use it for, you know, alms, giving, you know, alms, comes from zakawa. Zakawat sometimes means purity, sometimes means growth. So scholars say the reason zakat is called zakat is because by giving zakat, your money grows, or your money becomes clean and pure. But it seems that maybe it's more than that. It's not that your money becomes clean. By giving zakat, your heart becomes clean. Not just your money. If you look at these ayat in the Quran, you would see that actually giving money purifies our heart. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, خُذْ مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ صَدَقَةً. It's a very beautiful ayah. O Rasulullah, take from their possession sadaqah, charity, donation, or, you know, zak, alms. خُذْ مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ صَدَقَةً. Sometimes, you know, or many times we think sadaqah is just for helping poor people, for helping needy people. Or for example, we want to make a masjid, we want to make a hospital, we want to make a school. So we need money. We take sadaqah from people, donation from people to meet these needs. This is not the main purpose of sadaqah. The main purpose of sadaqah is to purify people. The main beneficiary is the person who gives, not the person who receives. If we knew the significance of sadaqah, we would all have gone out of our way to find a place or a person to give sadaqah. Rasulullah is asked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to take sadaqah from people, charity. Why? خُذْ مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ صَدَقَةً تُزَكِّيهِمْ وَتُطَهِّرُهُمْ بِهَا. By taking money from them, you purify them. So how Rasulullah is doing tazkiyah? By taking money from people. Of course, it's not only money. You can sometimes ask people to give time. You can sometimes ask people to give their, I don't know, reputation, their, you know, fame. Sometimes maybe even people have to give their life. But certainly always money is important to be given. There is no way that we can reach piety without giving money. لَن تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا مِمَّا تُحِبُّونَ. You know, some of the ayat we have read a lot, but we have not grasped. The ayah is telling us, no matter what good things you do, helping people, for example, visiting ill people, making, for example, you know, people happy by visiting them, being kind to your parents, your children, your neighbors, these are all good. But you have also to give money. Money has to be coming out of your pocket. I will explain why. لَن تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا. Unless you give charity. But what do you give? I have something extra in basement, I want to give. No, no. Mimma tuhibbun. This doesn't work unless you give what you love. Not just what those people who receive love. This is not enough. Maybe they are in such a terrible situation that whatever I give them, they love it. Even if I give them second-hand, you know, dress, they need. If I give you a food which was, give them a food which was in the fridge for 1 week, they are hungry, they love it. This is not enough for me. Maybe for them is enough. I have to give what I love. Hatta tunfiqu mimma tuhibbun. Some people say what you love to be given, but no, this is not enough. Not what you love to be given. What you love to give, to keep for yourself. You have to give what you love to keep for yourself. What is important for you, what is valuable for you. So, zakat, which here means general charity, it can be zakat, it can be khums, it can be donations. Any charity is very important, not to help people, to help ourselves. خُذْ مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ صَدَقَةً تُطَهِّرُهُمْ وَتُزَكِّيهِمْ بِهَا وَصَلِّ عَلَيْهِمْ. And send your salutation to them, salute them. إِنَّ صَلَاتَكَ سَكَنٌ لَهُمْ. And this will bring serenity, tranquility to them. When you give your money for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then inshallah you would feel sukoon. Why? One reason is this. Because as long as you are attached to money, you have to always go through a stress and disturbance. But if by giving money, you disconnect yourself from dunya, then there is no reason to worry. This is not miraculous. This is very natural. Inna salataka sakanun lahum wallahu sami'un alim. Another ayah is qad aflaha man tazakka. Qad aflaha man tazakka. What does tazakki mean? Although some people said it means to give zakat, but in reality, tazakki means the one who is seeking purity. Tazakki. Another ayah. Alladhi yu'ti malahu yatazakka. The one who gives his money while he is seeking purity. So, it shows that, if we want to summarize what we said so far, it shows that we are all in need of purification. In order to purify ourselves, we cannot just wash our body and dress. If it was as easy as that, you know, just washing your body and dress, it was good. Or just to do some a'mal. No. We need a big surgery. You have to be admitted in hospital for surgery. And the surgeon is Rasulullah. And he comes and he takes out from your heart all these sources of impurity. How does he do that? By asking you to give money. By asking you to give dunya. By asking you to remove attachment to dunya from your heart. This is why Rasulullah said, "Hubbu dunya ra'su kulli khati'ah." The source, the root of all the mistakes, all the problems, the greatest germ is hubbu dunya. Some people say, "Hubbu dinar ussu kulli khati'ah." So either it's hubbud dinar or hubbud dunya, because we have more hadith about hubbud dunya. Hubbud dunya ra'su kulli khati'a. Then Rasulullah has an addition. He says, ala tara kayfa ahabba ma abghadahu Allah. If you want to understand why hubbud dunya is the foundation and the root of all mistakes, you have to consider the one who loves dunya excessively, because hubbud dunya means to have excessive love for dunya. He is loving something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dislikes. Allah says, for you, my creation, my servant, dunya is nothing. Imagine if you bring some people for education to a school and say, you know, I have made for you these classrooms, library, laboratory, teachers, everything, textbooks. And instead of that, they just, you know, start playing with the soil in the, you know, courtyard of the school. But for soil, you could have done, you know, this before a school. I have brought you to benefit from this education. So the one who loves dunya, Rasulullah says, he is loving something that Allah dislikes. كَيْفَ أَحَبَّ مَا أَبْغَضَهُ اللَّهِ وَأَيُّ خَتَئٍ أَشَدُّ جُرْمًا مِنْ هَذَا. What crime is greater than this? Allah says, this is the least important thing, and then you make dunya the most important thing. This is a big crime. So, Islamic spirituality is not a matter of doing some actions, doing some exercises, not to, for example, eat, not to drink, not to sleep, not to mix with people. These are not guaranteeing. I'm not saying these are not helpful. I'm saying, but these don't guarantee any success. Sometimes even these can be problematic. The main thing is one thing, tazkiyatun nafs, purity of the soul. That's the main thing. If the purity of soul is there, even with little things that you do, you can progress. Qalilun min ad-du'a ma'al birr. If you are muttaqi and do little dua, it can help you. The hadith says it is like salt in food. When you make food, how much salt you need to have? Little. If you are muttaqi, if you are pure, little dua can help you. If there is no taqwa, there is no purity, day and night you pray, day and night you do ziyara, tawassul, shafa'a, doesn't count. Innama yataqabbalullahu minal muttaqin. Allah accepts from muttaqin. Of course, a muttaqi tries to do more. I'm not saying you shouldn't do more, but I'm saying that first make sure that you are in the right direction, then do more. You know, sometimes we are so much in hurry that we don't make sure that this is right direction. We just want to speed up. Imagine, for example, I want to go from one town to another town. I say, I'm very much in hurry. Let's first go, and then we see where we are going. It doesn't work. Al-amilu ala ghayr basira la yaziruhu sur'atu sayr illa bu'da. If someone acts without insight, the faster he goes, the farther he goes away from his destination. So, taqwa. This is what we have to invest on. Purity, piety, and this is very much a matter of heart, not surface, not actions. Actions are good, but still actions are not that deep as heart. There are people who have good actions. When you look at the physics of actions, They say prayer, mashallah, very good. But does this mean that necessarily they are good people? There are people who speak very nice. Allah says about munafiqeen that when they speak, you like to listen. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يُعْجِبُكَ قَوْلُهُ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. They speak so nicely about, you know, dunya, about politics, about justice, all these things. You think, oh, these are angels. But in their heart is nothing. So you cannot judge people by their words. You cannot judge people by their actions. It's only heart. And we don't have access to the heart. So we don't really understand who is good, who is bad. Unless you spend some time with people, if you have insight, you can understand. So we don't want to be judgmental, but at least about ourselves, we have to be careful. We don't want to be suspicious about people, but with respect to ourselves, we have to be suspicious. Al-mu'minu dhaninun binafsih. Unfortunately, we try to be suspicious about other people. But mu'min is not suspicious about people, he's suspicious about himself or herself. If you have a disease, if God forbid you are diagnosed for having cancer, what are you going to do? Are you going to forget yourself and going around and say, you have cancer, you have cancer, you have cancer? This is not going to help you. Treat yourself. And unless you are 100% sure that your cancer is treated, don't stop. If you are 100% sure that your cancer is treated, then you can be nosy about other people. You have big problem here. Why you try to be nosy? Tuba liman shagalahu ayubuhu an ayubal akharin. We have so many problems in ourselves that we have no time to think who has problem. You know, sometimes I tell brothers and sisters, we must be so much busy about treating ourselves that not only we don't feel bad about what people do or say with us, even we should not be noticing. You know, when someone is very focused and has very limited time, doesn't bother what people say or do. You know, imagine, for example, you have very big exam in 1 hour and you have to remember many things and be focused. Even if people are, you know, shouting and fighting, you know, you don't bother. Because you say, you know, I have to be focused. I don't have any time to waste. I don't want any distraction. Sometimes, you know, people show respect to you. Sometimes they don't show respect. Don't take it seriously. Just be focused. One of the ulama says, I was working on tafsir of Quran. And one, you know, friend was passing by me and hit me. Trying to annoy me, just as a, you know, kidding. So he hit me and I didn't pay any attention. He said, I hit you. I said, I have something to do. You know, I don't have time to waste. I am focusing on my study. When my study is finished, then we can play. But now, I am focused. Dunya is like this. Dunya is very serious. Dunya, for some people, is game. But for mu'min, it is not game. إِنَّمَا الدُّنْيَا لَعِبٌ وَلَحْوٌ وَزِينَةٌ وَتَفَاخُرٌ بَيْنَكُمْ وَتَكَاثُرٌ فِي الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَوْلَادِ. This is for some people. They are busy, you know, I have to finish my school, then I have to finish my university, my job, my children, you know. First they want to have child, then they want to see their children going to a school, then they want to see their children, I don't know, graduating, they want to see their children marrying, they want to see grandchildren. They are always busy with these things. These are not bad things, but these are just on the margin. The main focus is, am I becoming a better person or not? Imagine I have children and grandchildren and they are all, mashallah, happy and successful, but I have myself not achieved anything. يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ. These are not going to help me. Illa man atallah biqalbin salim. If you have qalb salim, inshallah your money also helps you. Your children also would help you if you have qalb salim. But if you don't have qalb salim, they are not going to help you. So mu'min is very focused, very determined to treat himself or herself. And you know, this, although may look difficult, but it's actually easier than what other people do. Because other people have too many problems. You know, they say, I have problem with my father and mother. I have problem with my brothers and sisters. I have problem with my classmate. I have problem with my boss. I have problem with my colleagues. I have problem with my neighbors. But mu'min says, I have one problem, and that's me. I find the greatest challenge for me is to help improve myself. This makes life much easier. Then you see the people who are around, they are not that bad. So you have two choices, either to say, I am bad, or you say, everyone else is bad. Which one is easier? To say, I am bad is easier. But it's not easy for people to accept this. Our first assumption, and second assumption, and third assumption is, if there is anything wrong, it's because of people. If there is anything between me and a friend, a brother, a sister, husband, wife, it's because of the other party. I am ma'asum. How can I make mistake? You know, unconsciously or consciously, we think we are ma'asum. For everything we have some reason, for everything we have some explanation, and we just put blame on other people. This is the place to measure your purity. The one who is purified, let me give you some signs. How can you see you are purified? The one who is purified has to be clean from arrogance. Because arrogance is one of the biggest sources of impurity. Maybe it's the main source. What was the problem with Shaitan? Arrogance. Aba wastakbara. He was arrogant. He had istikbar. So, if you are humble, inshallah, I'm not saying 100% because we have to check other things. But if you are humble, there is a chance that you can be pure. If you are not humble, forget being pure. You are not pure. It's impossible to be arrogant, to feel you are better than other people, and then say, I am pure. So humbleness is very, very important. Be able to admit your mistakes. With these two things, 99% of people are dismissed. Just ask people two things. Are you humble and admit your mistakes easily? How many times every day you admit your mistakes? You know, every day we do hundreds of things and we say hundreds of things. So you say all of them are correct? Why we are not able to understand our mistakes? And why we are not brave to admit our mistakes? If we are pure, if only truth is important for us, why we are not able to find out? Our disaster is so serious that we even don't, you know, cry over our tragedy. You know, sometimes in Arabic they say the greatest tragedy is what makes you laugh. You know, our tragedy is so great that we cannot even cry. We laugh at ourselves. I very much love these people. You know, there are people, very few, that they easily say, I made mistake. You don't need to argue with them. They say, I learned from you. I was wrong, you are right. You know, if you have these people around, appreciate, because these are people that are very close to inshallah be good mu'min. Either they are good mu'min or very close, because they don't have arrogance, they don't have bias. They find their honor in complying with the truth. Arrogance is to make truth comply with you. Arrogance is that you don't bother about truth. You want everything to comply with you. Even you want truth to serve you. But if you are happy with serving the truth, this is humbleness. So, purity is something that cannot be measured by superficial things. Humbleness, seeking the truth, accepting the truth, admitting your mistakes, trying to be critical of yourself. These are the signs of a person who is inshallah pure. Now inshallah what we will try to do is to mention some of the inshallah major signs of the people who get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we try to explore the notion of nearness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and see how we can do this journey from impurity to purity, from what we are to a station that inshallah we will be near Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa akhiru da'wana and alhamdulillah rabbil alam.
So they're going to a break for Sana, inshallah.